Have we witnessed another Sputnik moment? The Financial Times has reported that China tested a hypersonic missile this summer, though China denies this. General Mark Milley, chairman of the Joint Chief of Staff, compared the test to the Soviet Union's Sputnik launch during the Cold War.
I don't know if it's quite a Sputnik moment, but I think it's very close to that.
General Milley should dust off his history books. The Chinese test has nothing in common with Sputnik, and saying so feeds a dangerous paranoia growing in Washington these days. To recall, the Soviet Union launched Sputnik, the first man-made satellite to orbit the planet, on October 4, 1957. Both the US and the USSR had been planning to launch satellites into space for years, and the fact that Moscow got there first was a huge shock to Americans. Coming in the wake of multiple powerful Soviet nuclear tests, Sputnik signaled that in the next frontier, space, the Soviets were ahead. Sputnik was a revolution in the space race. Hypersonic missiles, on the other hand, are very old news. A hypersonic missile travels at 5 times the speed of sound. Starting in 1959, the United States and the Soviet Union deployed intercontinental ballistic missiles that traveled around 20 times the speed of sound. Even Germany's V-2 rockets, first launched against Paris during the last phase of World War II, flew at close to hypersonic speeds. Cameron Tracy, a Stanford scientist and expert on the topic, has pointed out that hypersonic weapons are neither faster nor stealthier than ICBMs. Oh, and by the way, that Chinese missile missed its target by 24 miles. As Fred Kaplan, the author and journalist, notes, it's possible that the test was China's attempt to nullify America's vast missile defense system. But that system, as he points out, is an expensive white elephant that failed 3 of its last 6 tests, despite hundreds of billions of dollars that have been spent on it to date. Perhaps that's why the Pentagon hasn't even tested the system since the spring of 2019. And even if the system had perfect aim, it could still be rendered useless with small asymmetrical measures, like simply firing 2 missiles at the same time. Alas, don't expect science and facts to have much sway in this discussion. That is because there is now a bipartisan consensus in Washington. We're coming dangerously close to a new Cold War. For the Pentagon, it's an opportunity. Raising fears about a huge and tech-savvy enemy is a surefire way to guarantee vast new budgets that can be spent countering the enemy's every move, real and imagined. The mood goes beyond Washington. Foreign Affairs has published an essay by the scholar and famous realist John Mearsheimer, who castigates American policymakers for engaging China for the last 4 decades. He predicts that our active encouragement of a peer competitor will lead to a new Cold War that could get hot and even nuclear. But realist logic only gets you so far. The high priest of realism, Kenneth Waltz, often predicted that once the Cold War ended and Japan had gotten strong, it would throw off the shackles of dependence on America for security and acquire nuclear weapons. Mearsheimer himself predicted in 1990 that as the Cold War ended, NATO would collapse and Europe would become a cockpit of warring states as it had been before the Cold War. He believed that many European states, chiefly Germany, would likely acquire nuclear weapons. None of these predictions have come to pass. In fact, the European Union has grown tighter and stronger in the decades after the Cold War, and Japan's military remains resolutely non-nuclear. I raise this to make the point that Mearsheimer looked at only one of the great forces that motivate states in the international system, power politics. But there are others, like economic interdependence. The world today is thoroughly enmeshed in a complex global economic system in which war would hurt the aggressor nearly as much as the victim. There have been almost no land grabs since 1945, the most notable exception being Russia's annexation of Crimea in 2014. This amounts to an almost unprecedented declaration of respect for borders. In addition, nuclear deterrence has raised the stakes, making countries far more cautious about launching a great power war. The task of American foreign policy is to recognize that traditional power politics can indeed deter Chinese expansionism, while also recognizing the ways in which interdependence might constrain it. The U.S. should make an effort to deploy both tools. This approach will certainly prove far more complicated to implement than scaremongering and chest thumping. But it is precisely the one that is likely to keep the world at peace and prosperity.